so, yeah, go ahead. Moving on to superintendent's report.
I have a number of items this evening. We'll start off with Crabtree is here to go through the high school renovation project. We are at the point, we're at an exciting point, you'll see later in the agenda, that we will authorize hopefully to go out to bid. But Crabtree will start off with a preview of what the building looks like as its final step before we go out to bid. So I will turn it over to Kelsey and Jeff.
Hey, Dr. Sokas.
Matt, do you want to turn that second one on?
I do.
So what we're going to do is, we had walked the board through the interior before. We had an update to that. A lot of the finishes changed as we just finalized a meeting with the district, for instance, incorporating whether it's logo of the school district, colors, or school colors, things of that nature, and finalized selection of flooring or light fixtures. What we're going to do is about a 3-minute sort of that goes through the main lobby and down into one of the classroom wings. Then we'll go to a PowerPoint that just has still images from this presentation. It's a little bit easier to go to still images than trying to jump back and forth to the exact section. But this will give you a sense of the involvement. So what you're doing now is it's turning, it's looking into the library. You can see small work room, breakout rooms for students, project rooms, view into the library at that location. You can see the final sort of overall open structure, finishes, again, very cost effective. The roof deck that you see is a painted metal. It has the color of wood, but it's metal for cost efficiency. Block construction, essentially we're leaving the whole structure exposed so that you're not paying for drop ceilings. Light fixtures are actually locally produced. We met with the manufacturers, I think they're actually $300 a piece, so we're looking at every part of the project for cost. We're now stepping into the food court section of the building. Some very limited amounts of wood that you see, for instance, at the pantry there. Then as we start, now we're coming out of the food court, we've just gone past the middle school cafeteria. The high school cafeteria is right off to the right where it's existing location. That is not a real stone, it's a manufactured stone, but it has that look, the color is throughout, so if anything gets chipped. We're now in cafeteria. Acoustical bats help with sound in that space. Then you go back out. This is the open collaborative area, space for the building. You can see, for instance, the district's logo, restrooms at that in that block of construction right there. And this will be the open collaborative area that we share throughout the building. We do have LVT laminate flooring. You remember we had a discussion of BCT laminate flooring or terrazzo. For cost purposes, we went with the LVT flooring. Graphics on the wall, those are painted stencils. And now we're stepping back into the fashion wing with those. These are painted concrete block masonry walls. We do have some accents at the collaborative areas. We have a wood that turns up the ceiling, which is exposed structure against, again, the stenciled logo of the district, incorporating some of the colors. The colors changed a lot over the past few months. Again, we're going into one of the classroom rooms, painted concrete block for cost efficiency. Stepping into one of the classrooms. Accent color of, against the exterior wall. Again, incorporating district colors. And going back out the hallway. And then as we go down to the end of the hallway, we've got the elevator on the left side, and this is the collaborative area that we'll be looking out at the play fields at the back of the site. And then you can see out through the window the other three-story tower as well at that location. Okay. So that sort of gives a 3-minute feel of the overall building. We're going to now go to some still images. space, but LVT flooring, manufactured stone on the one wall on the right, tile work on the left side. We went through with an oversized tile that cuts down on the labor for installation. Open structure that you see there, and then a painted metal roof deck as well, a five with actually drywall where you can't get to. And then you have light fixtures going down to the comments, just sort of a straightforward fixture. Again, the discussion the whole way through design is really sort of having this barn, you know, agrarian style open structure, and let that be the accent of the building, not put a lot of high-end finishes or floating ceilings and things like that. This is a view, and it's a little hard to see this on the front of the building, the glass right next to the entry. This is the entrance to the auditorium, so sort of hallway right there, and then what you're seeing in the black there is the two entrances into the cafeteria. It will also be, into the auditorium, and you also have a logo of the school district that you can see tonight when you see it. The work or project rooms right off the library, essentially two on each side, flanking the entrance to the library. Looking into the library at that location. The middle school cafeteria, we had earlier spoken to you about some graphics that you see on that, for instance, that far wall. We went more with a subdued graphic that we spoke to the district that we're using with the library here that mimics sort of a rusted material, but we're also utilizing on the exterior building. And then going down through, this is sort of the cafe area right off the collab, as well as the serving line. Just a view in the serving lines. The four large overhead doors that the students can move in and out of that space very quickly, and then either move over to the middle school or move into the high school cafeteria. View into the high school cafeteria. We have acoustics. The metal deck out in the main commons is an acoustical absorption. Here we have a baffle system that you're seeing up on the ceiling. We don't have as much room or volume that we have in the large commons, so sound dissipate here is a more confined space, so those baffles will help control the sound a little more. And that the collaborative area right outside the two cafeterias, and then a stencil for obviously the Trojans, as well as the district's logo. And then stepping back into the classroom wings, again, hallways painted concrete block, but then the focus of these collab areas really is just a transition to a paint with a stencil of logo, and then we do have some wood that turns up the ceiling, and then just exposing the structure and painting it around the room. We also have that area is carpeted just to have sort of more of a soft seating system. Two things. It serves as it opens up the corners and intersections of the hallways so you don't get traffic congestion when students are moving, but also gives them a breathing area throughout the day. Different options. These are also all these collab areas are teaching areas for classes can occur, or a large group of multiple classes can come together here. And then the collabs at the end of each of the classroom. This is the entrance to, coming in the athletic entrance. So this is the main high school gymnasium. Really, we're not moving a lot. We're just upgrading the finishes in that location. We do display cases. You see the logo over on the right side, keeping the skylight, the existing skylight, which is being laid down. And then a view into the gymnasium. Sanding the floors gives us the great opportunity to change up. Do some accents, stains, and just branding for the district, obviously, on the two ends with your logos. Okay. So that was a real quick overview. Really not a lot has changed, except more the final color selections is what's changed on the exterior. So we wanted to make sure everybody had a chance to see that and question for everyone.
think what's one of the things that we've talked about in the last couple weeks is we're now 3 years into this project at this point. And so when you think about it, three more years out will be when the project's finished. So, you know, it's been a long time. A lot of hours have gone into it, and, you know, certainly I think it's an exciting step for the district, and I want to thank you guys for your support. You know, this is one hurdle, is approving to go out to bid. The next hurdle is once those bids open up and we see what those numbers are. Certainly, it is exciting to see where the possibilities are going to be for our district.
Any new projections on cost?
The cost that we presented at the last presentation, that's what we're holding right now. We're all, you know, obviously the market fluctuates daily. We can all see it in the news, but I think we're holding. The last published data that we have on construction costs is what we presented. So.
Where are we with the bond on that to secure that and set that?
They're in the process of they need to do it. They're setting up the rating agency call. That hasn't happened, but we really should have the number before we do anything. How much we're going to borrow? We do have the number, just we don't need 62 million. We should borrow 62 million. So it's rolling on there.
The next item I have is there's a scholarship request to set up for Rachel Cox. You'll see that information, part of why we're looking to move that and approve that is so that it can be awarded this year. The criteria there is for a senior girls basketball who has exemplified drive and determination. And the first year is a $500 scholarship, and then I believe on June 5th is a 5K. So if you're interested in doing a 5K, certainly there is one to benefit Rachel on, I think it's June 5th, Sunday. So that will be on the agenda for approval. The other item is the FFA State Convention. This is typically something that our FFA group does. It's exciting. If you look, we're projected to have 35 to 40 students attending this. It's exciting to have that many students in that group going along. And I had told Allison that since this is a typical trip that we take every year, that she didn't need to come and present. But that would be on the agenda for approval on the 17th. We do have next election day is May 17th for the primaries, and so we will be moving the board meeting to Bethel Elementary for that meeting as part of our rotation, and it will take place in the cafeteria. We traditionally put them in the libraries, but I think we kind of get a little crunched, if you will, in some of the libraries, so we're going to shift it to the cafeteria to give some more space to spread out. So just note that. The other item I have is policy 201. It was brought up during public participation last time in a request that we look at the admission policy for policy 201 for kindergartners. I did put together and provided you all the admission policies for kindergartners through the districts. The majority of them have September 1st as the deadline. And then it varies based off of whether or not they allow early admission testing and whatnot. Mimi and I did look at where, remember the last policy was updated. We did look back and kind of took a look at what our old policy looked like and what the new one looked like. And the policy was significantly shortened when our policy reflected what PSBA at that time was recommending. And when Mimi inquired why they were looking to recommend that, it was basically that they're trying to get rid of all the special circumstances and policies and kind of shorten some things and make it a little bit more defined. And I think that's part of you know, some of our experiences in the past in working with our enrollment, it made sense that we put a fixed date in there and kind of remove that possibility for early testing. So I guess the decisions that we need to make are, where do we see, you know, is this something we want to address now? Is it something we want to leave the policy in place? We just need some direction as to which way to head, or if we're good with our policy. But if you do look, the majority of them do have September 1st as that deadline. I think, yeah, kind of open it up.
I agree, if we're going through our policies, and we want, I think a static date is the best option, whether that's August 15th, August 30th, September 1st, September 15th, I think we need a static date. But I also, this is from my perspective, I also don't want to jump policies ahead of one another as we're doing our natural progression. I think we should just work through our policies as we see fit. Keep moving right along with that. This is my opinion. Anybody else has any thoughts?
I think if we set a date, that's the date.
Yep.
The day after.
Correct.
The day is the day.
So, are we good with just fixing that as we evaluate our policies just in this natural progression, or do we want to bump that policy up to accommodate this school year?
Because we're going to miss by a week or two.
So we are on pace, so we could do one of two things. Mimi, how we've done the 100s, doing the 200s, we would hit the 200s for final approval in September. So we'd miss it by several weeks, that policy, so school would have started. We can set a schedule where there's overlapping, where we're approving. What we're trying to do is clear, approve, and then the next month introduce. We can overlap as well. You know, we could have the month that we're approving, we're also introducing a new set of policies.
So we'll do a first read at the same time as we do a final. So one session will be first read and final read, and then the rest of the next month.
The other option is, you know, we could suspend. We could temporarily suspend policy 201 and set the date of September 1st in a temporary situation, and then when we hit 201, we can do it, you know, in the natural progression and say, you know, in looking back, and Mimi and I have kind of gone back and forth, I don't, you know, typically I wouldn't recommend that we move policies up and jump, because you could get yourself, you know, constantly trying to hit a moving target. The only thing I will say is, you know, in the past, in this situation, if we would start the Monday before Labor Day, this situation, they would be able to start kindergarten. We did kind of shift to meet some more of the other districts are in BCTC last year and this year. We shifted it to that Wednesday prior. And so that day, you know, we have shifted our start date a little. So, you know, I can support making that change, given that we've changed some of our practices as well.
I mean, I'm all for supporting the community, and if it's, you know, I want to just, you know, there's always going to be some child that, you know, whether the birthday 2nd, September 2nd, August 28th, but in this instance, I think the majority of the other school districts are September 1st, and that's pretty close to Labor Day, so I'd be for looking at it and moving the policy up to accommodate the child.
Yeah, I think as long as, which I believe a majority of us are okay with moving to a set date, as long as the majority of us are willing to do that, I think we just move this policy up, because we don't want to, through the natural progression, let it go, and 2 weeks after school starts, we approve this.
We'll work on that policy and we'll have it for the next week. The final part of my report is I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Charles, our Pupil Service Director. We are currently working through our comprehensive plan. The comprehensive plan is due by August 31st to the state. The overall plan will be presented to the board in June for approval then in July. But there's a piece of it that is due earlier. It's always due a couple months, you know, a month or two ahead of the overall plan, and that is the special ed piece. So I will turn it over to Mr. Charles.
Good evening, board members. Sticking with the general overview theme, rather than go line by line on 72 pages of our special ed plan, let me give you a general overview. So every 3 years, the district is tasked with putting together the special ed comprehensive plan to ensure that all of our special education programs and schools are appropriate, compliant, and effective. You'll notice our plan is dated 2021 to 2024. The reason of that back date, all our district did get an extension due to COVID. Some general enrollment information. There are approximately 1,323 students enrolled in the district. Of those 1,300 students, 335 are receiving special education services. It's just over 25% of our total student enrollment. Compare that to the state average of special education enrollment. The state average is 18%, just over. So that 7% difference doesn't sound like a lot, but it really is. Since starting really getting into the district, I attribute that to just we were using outdated assessment tools previously, and we're also been working on reevaluation properly. A lot of times the students will be identified very on in early elementary, and then they won't get tested until high school. So kind of that attributes that high number. Mr. Ryan Gallagher, our school psychologist, he's been doing a great job of really updating our testing procedures, our testing tools, to make sure that we are doing all their job of identifying students and aligning them up with the resources that they need. So like I said, I'm just going to touch on some specific sections of the plan that I feel like the district either focus on or some highlights. Really, I want to look at the school district's areas of improvement planning. This is 14 indicators that are highlighted each year by the Special Education Data Report. Of those 14 indicators, there was only one indicator that the district was flagged on for meeting improvement. And in that indicator, it was post-school outcomes that's broken down into three different categories. Target A, we have students enrolling in higher education within 1 year of leaving high school. Target B, with students enrolling in either higher education or becoming competitively employed within 1 year, or students enrolling in higher education for another form of post-secondary education or a training program. Of those three areas, the only one this district was flagged on was students enrolling in higher education within 1 year of leaving high school. Our district rate was just shy of 24%, and the target rate is 28.5%. To answer that need, what we're going to do is add some career exploration activities next year that really focus on careers that are supported by attending higher education. While we were flagged for that, I do believe that is representative of our community. And a lot of our students are leaving and either getting jobs full time or they are seeking out trades and attending technical schools. So while we were flagged for it, I don't see that as a negative. An area of strength that's actually also on the next page was indicator 5, our educational environment. Anytime we consider special education services for a student, we always have to consider the least restrictive environment. We never want to place a student in a separate classroom or more restricted setting just because they have that disability. For us, that itinerant placement, the district rate is 74%, where the state average is 61.5%. So as you can see, we're way over that state average. We're doing a great job of including our students with disabilities in a regular education classroom with their non-disabled peers. Two things I feel directly contribute to that is the co-teaching model, what's utilized by many of our learning support teachers and some of our emotional support teachers, and also the support that our paraprofessionals are able to provide students in the classroom. Next section I'd like to look at is our significant disproportionality. This ensures that children with disabilities are properly identified for services, receive necessary services in the least restrictive environment, and are not disproportionately removed from their educational placement for discipline reasons. In these areas of placement, discipline, and identification, the district was not flagged for any disproportion. Okay. program, our student assistance program. Recently, we brought on full-time a board certified behavior analyst who's been able to support our special education and regular education students. Our partnership with the Burks County Counseling Center, the Tulsa Pride Program, and then also our safety care, which is our de-escalation and restraint, but for almost 40 staff members are currently trained. Looking at our education program profile, just looked at our caseload, FTE, and our special education facilities themselves. Looking at the caseload FTE, what that number is the legal limit of how many students are able to be on special education teachers or service providers' caseload. All our teachers are in great shape as far as numbers. Our speech providers, they are allowed to have 65 students on their caseload. When we had that two full-time positions, they were both 59-60, so we're really reaching that cap. But with the addition of that part-time position, we'll be good for another, I predict, 3 to 5 years. And then the last area I'll touch on briefly is our special education personnel development. These are trainings that we highlight that we want to provide for special education staff and also the community. Training topics will include autism, positive behavior supports for paraprofessionals, transition, literacy, parent trainings, and IEP development. Parent trainings is one thing I really want to focus on. One initiative I would like to start next year, and it'll be a goal of mine, is to provide a monthly parent outreach. I'd like to design this to be a parent community outreach series where once a month we use this room here, we open it up to the community to come in, and we have just a small presentation on more general special ed topics, and then as the year progresses, really narrow in and focus on the community need and kind of have a general forum for parents to come and ask those questions. One thing I've noticed working with families, especially of our younger students, is they're not always aware of the community resources or the school district resources available to them. Getting them linked up with those sources or resources earlier, I think will have a really strong impact. So you do have the full plan for your review. It will also be posted on our district website for public review as well. If you have any questions or concerns about that, of course, ask them now or we'll hear you out.
On the early identification training, are we still focusing on the K through third for early identification? As far as like autistic or dyslexia or anything like that?
So I don't know that we target those grades specifically, but we do have our response intervention models in place for students that are struggling. That I would say focuses a lot on our K through three students.
So Taylor, real quick, this would be posted to the special ed page, correct?
Yes.
Posted there.
Yeah, there will be a separate tab. It'll most likely say news, and it'll be found under there. It'll either be a PDF or a direct document viewer, so it'll be right there.
So this will appear, as Taylor said, it has to sit by state code for 28 days for public comment, public review, and then after 28 days it can be board approved as a standalone plan.
All right. Are there any citizens or students that wish to address the board pertaining to agenda items only? Please stand and state your name.
Tom Moorhead. Could I have the current estimate for the cost of the junior-senior high school renovation project? I understand the number is going to change.
Where it stands is the building itself without the alternates is about $69 million.
Okay. Does that include any monies for the parking lot change on this property, or is that a separate expense?
That's a separate project.
Okay, thank you.
Stand up, say your name, please.
Lisa Hassler. The review of the building, I was fascinated by the architecture and the finishes and everything, but the thing that I found alarming was it took me to Columbine. Everything's open concept, concerned about safety and you know, somebody comes in there, is it bulletproof glass? I mean, maybe I'm thinking beyond things, but it's like everything's exposed, and I understand that. I'm just asking the question. The other thing that I noticed too is, and I love the open concept as far as the beams and stuff like that, and I'm thinking about heating and cooling, you know, with the rise of it, I didn't see fans in order to, you know, alternate them to push the heat or the air down to keep it more fluent.
I actually thought the same thing about the fans. I'm wondering if they're just not showing. I can't imagine some of those spaces not having something.
Right.
Unless it's some sort of reverse air handle or something.
I didn't know if there was something built into the heating and cooling system that there's no need for that, but that was the thing that I noticed with the, you know, normally you have that, but maybe there's something commercially that's different.
So the glass itself, up to 7 feet, and you correct me if I'm wrong, Jeff, will be wrapped with a ballistic covering.
Okay.
As far as Columbine, there has been a huge shift, and again, Jeff, your expertise is more on this, but there's been a shift instead of where it used to be lock down, secure yourself in a room, it's been get out of the building and go. So you'll see that in a lot of schools, there's now a shift instead of individual rooms and hiding.
Okay.
It's more open so that they can get out and disperse.
Okay, thank you.
And I don't know if you want to follow up or anything.
Yeah, the building's been designed based on CIPTED or crime prevention through environmental design principles. It's a national movement that includes planners, architects, engineers, first responders, so law enforcement, EMS services, everybody that would react to an event. We actually nationally train side by side in this training and how both the design of the buildings, specifically obviously in this case, safety and security, those principles were embedded into this building as Dr. Nesbitt mentioned. All the glass main entries and the surrounding glass is laminated glazing. And I'm going to get to a little bit of technicalities. Law enforcement actually, when you speak to them, do not want the glass to be bulletproof. They want it to be laminated. So laminated, you can take glass and you can hit it with a sledgehammer for an hour and you're not getting in.
Okay.
You are correct. There are principles of the main open spaces. What law enforcement actually, they don't... In large gathering areas, they want them to be open so that people can move out of those areas very quickly if something would happen.
Okay.
The other comment is law enforcement typically want you to be able to look in the spaces because if an event would occur, law enforcement can also clear a building very quickly. If there are hiding spaces, a standard law police officer can't clear a building. Standard operating procedure for law enforcement is if you can't see into space, you are not allowed to clear that space. You have to call essentially SWAT teams that have special training in that. So that's part of the reason that things are left open. We are embedding in the classrooms, and it's small nuances that there are the ability to shelter in place. And I don't want to get into that just more for logistics here. But that is all embedded into the project. As far as fans, you're correct, we're not showing everything in the building. In this case, the HVAC is not requiring fans down through the main hall, and they do on some projects. This project is based on U.S. Green Building Council for sustainability. So right now it's tracking about 25-30% more efficient than a national standard school. And that was a request by the school district so that we're not just looking at cost now, but what is the cost of operating this building over 30 or 40 years.
What's behind that stone? What's that stone mounted with? What do we have there?
That wall that's right behind it is a difficult wall because essentially we were removing the old structure, so there's multiple backings behind that wall. Everything from brick to concrete block to openness, steel structure, and that was one of the reasons that we did sheet that whole one wall was to clean it up because essentially it was switching back and forth because of the old hallway.
And that was the most cost effective way to do it.
Yeah, but we had to sheet
presentation. All right, so we'll move on to buildings and grounds. Mr. Heck.
I'm going to authorize the administration, Crabtree, Waldorf, and Associates to solicit bids for junior senior high school renovation project.
We are voting on A and B, is that correct? I second the motion. Roll call.
Hatcher.
Yes.
Lidle.
Yes.
Heck.
Yes.
Bats.
Yes.
Coffin.
Yes.
Hall.
Yes.
Palmer.
Yes.
Then we have, we're also going to vote on this, approve the agreement with Aramark to serve as commissioning agent and contract with Quality Assurance Plus for the junior senior high school renovation project.
Awesome.
Sure. So, part of the process of the bidding is that the commissioning agent must be brought on board, and they must review the bids ahead of time and make sure the specs are where they are. The bulk of the commissioning work will take place on the tail end, but we have to have an agreement in place for the start of the bidding. So, you know, Jeff, would it be accurate to say, you know, 2-3% of the work is up front, and then 90-some plus percent is on the back end?
That's almost exactly the amount,
yeah.
Correct.
So what will happen is the Aramark will be the holder of this. They will employ Quality Assurance Plus, who will then also go out and then get other companies that they need to. But the nice part is Aramark, based off cost of projects and estimates, has come in at a much more competitive bid or a competitive price, as well as they're the one outfit that can do all of the commissioning, all of the areas that have to be addressed at that point. So it's kind of a one-stop shop, if you will.
Any questions or comments? Roll call.
Lidle.
Yes.
Heck.
Yes.
Bats.
Yes.
Coffin.
Yes.
Clough.
Yes.
Palmer.
Yes.
Hatcher.
Yes.
We have a contract in place that adds, that basically covers the junior senior high school project in order for Crabtree to do then this work on the current district office bus area. We would need to engage in an addendum or a separate contract. The easiest thing would be to add the addendum to the existing contract, and that will be on the agenda for the 17th. So as soon as we have that addendum, we'll get that out. So where we are with that project is we were trying to see if we stayed under an acre of disturbance, which allows it to stay local in the project as opposed to then kicking it up to county and land development. We were trying to push that timeline and then maybe potentially tack it on to the high school project as an alternate or an option that we can add on to that. The only problem with that is we can't get a surveyor here for about, you know, 5 weeks time frame, which is just not ideal, and we can't tack it on to the high school project. It'll have to be a standalone project. I guess the real question with that project is, once we kind of understand the surveying and we're looking at that, is there's two trains of thought. If we stay under an acre of land disturbance, we keep it within the township. If we go over an acre, then we have to get land development, correct? And the county gets involved, and that will slow down the process. It adds significant cost, it will also add significant time. So that's where it's one of those catch-22s. We think right now that an acre, under an acre of disturbance, will meet our needs, but it's also one of those things is, do you plan for the future and do it this way, or do you build for what you want? Stormwater has to be addressed within that acre of disturbance as well, so that adds, you know, what, so part of the survey is to see what, how that stormwater needs to be. Can it be through stone? Can it be through piping and underground piping and stone? So we're kind of, a lot of it hinges on getting that survey and then moving forward from there.
My recommendation still stands that I think we can keep it under an acre and keep it local and keep our costs significantly down. If we get involved in NPDES permitting and all that, if we're going to spend as much on engineering and all that as we will the project product. I originally thought if we kept it stone that they would consider that as impervious and wouldn't make us go through as much stormwater, but basically the county has gotten smart and they say that if you're going to stone it, you're probably going to pave it, and we're going to make you address that up front. So that was a little bit of a hiccup, but I still believe we can keep it under an acre and keep it local. I think it'd be in the district's best interest. See where we land.
And we had 2 or 3 weeks ago met with the township engineer, came out, walked the site, gave us ideas, gave us, you know, we know the setback of where we need to be off of the road, because it's a state road, so we have to be back so many feet. We know where we need to be on that. Positioning, you know, we know that, you know, probably to be good neighbors, we would look at some kind of screening, whether it be, you know, landscaping or fencing or however we would do that. So a lot of it, we've started to have those conversations. We met week and a half ago, with the engineer and Jeff to kind of start those discussions of where it needs to be and what it needs to look like and how do we stay under the acre. So we've been moving forward even without necessarily this engagement letter to see how fast we can do it. But a lot of it, like I said, hinges on that. That survey is going to slow us down. When Hesta was here last, well, when Hesta presented, I guess it was March, there was some questions about, or concerns about the baskets hanging off the wall, and what would the reality or cost be to swinging them up into the ceiling, and that's what those quotes are there for. The quote there would be $33,345. We'd take those four, it would demo those side baskets and swing them up into the ceiling.
So this is over and above the first quote?
Correct. No?
Oh.
Yes.
Cost-wise or to do? So 33.3.
Yes, it is.
Are we getting six baskets or four baskets?
Four baskets for the 33,000, which is electric and controlled winches to bring them up into the ceiling.
So essentially, we're looking at 48, so change. So it's a lot more economical to leave them the way they are and just do the 14,700 that we already approved. We already approved that.
No, we
didn't see the basketball.
We didn't approve any basketball maintenance. Basketball rim maintenance, backboard maintenance.
So we're still going to put these backboards on them. It's not even framing where it is.
That's in the first price there, isn't it?
The first price is a two
just
main.
The ones,
oh, just the
price on what it was just to replace the four side backboards, leaving the existing hardware there.
Andy and I talked about that. We could do that ourselves.
Okay.
We could do that ourselves, but there's no price just to replace them. In my opinion, that would be worth it. We could do that with our lift, buying four baskets and putting them up ourselves. Not a problem.
That's the way I do.
We have got this because there was some concern of people
hanging.
So that $37,000 issue.
I think your maintenance crew could also look at some sort of netting or screening or something that would make that a little bit less advantageous to jump off the new higher bleachers and hang on there somehow, way, shape, or form.
Some barbed wire?
I didn't say barbed wire.
Oh my gosh. Heston, could we close that at the bottom so that there is no access to the barn?
We can look at something. I the only other part where that would be balls would be getting stuck up there. But we can look at something. I got no problem with that. New baskets alone would be an improvement there. So are we all okay with having this on the agenda next time to do the basket upgrade? That way that completes that whole project down there and not doing anything with the side basket.
That is all I have.
Okay, moving on to finance, Mr. Vidal.
For a 2022-2023 preliminary budget, Tom's here to go over that with us.
Hey, thank you. An overview of the budget for next year. We're going to talk about the Act 1 index and the budget timeline, go over fund balances, go over revenue expenditures, the debt service, the history of our tax rate, and future tax protection. That's what we're going to kind of go over. The Act 1 index just came out recently, and our index is 3.4%. And for the first time ever, we have our adjusted index is also 3.4% because we don't get an adjustment because our A ratio is now under 0.4. It's at 0.38 and change. We're the second lowest, A ratio in the county. Kutztown has the highest, or the lowest. So with the Act 1 timeline, we typically before January you'd have to either pass the preliminary budget or pass a resolution saying you're not going to raise taxes over the index. And as every other year I've been here, we've never raised taxes over the index, so we passed a resolution saying we're not going to raise taxes. We did that in January. The preliminary budget approval will be in 2 weeks on May 17th. And the final budget approval will be on June 21st. So the next item is the fund balance, just to give you an idea of where we're at with fund balance and what we're planning on. So just to go over these items, the assigned fund balance, which is $40,000, that's just items that are either prepaid or due. That's insignificant. The committed fund balances are the items that the board by June 30th must decide on the names of these or what the committed pots are. The committed, right now we currently have the athletic facility. facility improvements. And at the end of June 30th, 2021, these were the amounts. $950,000 for athletic facility improvements. And that basically replaced the turf and the track. I'm not sure that's going to be enough. Recommending for, to put a little bit more in there. But again, those numbers are not decided now. Those are just my numbers I threw in there. The only thing we have to decide by June 30th is the committed pots, the committed titles of those different categories. We have $500,000 put aside for benefit increases. We've already hit the peak of, we're very close to the peak of the PEASRs. So I don't think we're going to have any big surprises there. Our health trust just approved a 1.5% increase. That could come back to bite us. I think the actuaries are recommending higher numbers for increases, but we're staying at 1.5. The special ed program, we keep $200,000 in there in case there's a settlement, a lawsuit, or due process that we have to pay. And curriculum, we've kind of put off some textbook purchases in the last couple budgets. And there's a big series coming up, so that may be used, some of that may be used. I just have to get with the curriculum director to find out where we're kind of starting all over again on that, on the curriculum cycle. So right now we've committed $2.02 million. And our unassigned fund balance as of June 30th of 2021 was $2.5 million, which is just under 8% of our expenditures. So for the general fund, we had fund balances of 4.6, and the capital reserve fund at June 30th was 7.4, for a total of 12 million and change. So just, and then I'll go over the bottom here, just to show you how we're arriving at the capital reserve, again, as of June 30th was $7.4 million. We've already paid architect fees from the capital reserve for the high school project of $2.6 million. We've had other expenditures in capital reserve of $150,000. And we did already transfer $1.45 million from the general fund to the capital reserve fund. So that brings us to $6,063,000. So that's where we're starting up there. Again, let's go back to the projections on the committed fund balances. I just, again, these are my numbers, and the board actually approves these numbers probably in November, once we get a feel how we finish the year. So, benefit increase, I reduced the athletic facility improvements. I'll say we should probably go up on that, because I think the turf and track will be more than that, or around that number. Special ed program, bringing down curriculum to 370 to 300, I think that's probably about right. So our total committed will come down from $2,020,000 to $1.85 million, and then our unassigned fund balance will be $2.75 million, which is, again, just under the 8% max that we have by the state. So the total general fund is 4.6, and then this is the capital reserve. We arrived at the, right now, as of today, we have $6,063,000 as the capital reserve fund balance. Estimating that we're going to spend probably $300,000 between now and the end of this fiscal year. We're probably going to have excess funds to the tune of about $1.5 million in this budget, and that will be transferred sometime in the fall once we get a final audit done. And then the budget that's currently being prepared has a $500,000 budgeted transfer to capital reserve to take care of our five-year capital plan that we have calls for a funding of that to keep it funded to pay for some of the things that we have planned. So the projected capital reserve fund balance would go to $7.7 million. At the end of this year. Again, we're going to start paying out of that 7.7, we will be paying a lot of the rest of the architect fees and some of the other fees associated with the high high school project, probably to the tune of about another $5 million out of that. We're not quite sure on those numbers yet, so. So that's where we are with fund balance, and...
The $320,000, is that towards the building, or is that other?
It could be towards Penn Burnville gym, could be, I just estimated that's, you know, that we're gonna get an architect fee, another architect bill. So...
So Tom, that includes the projects that we approved in March?
Yes.
For Penn Burnville?
So, I'll go through all this PowerPoint, and I'll go back to the spreadsheet and go over some of the things. Our warehouse, the revenue continues to grow, and I'll show you that. Our income tax, we're going to have, it's projected, trending to be the highest increase we've had in a while, so. And that's countywide, everybody's, for some reason, our income tax is which is nice. Real estate transfer tax comes in, came in high again, and I'll show you how bad I am at budgeting that revenue in a minute. So this is the sixth year in a row when the tax millage decreased, if we do that. And a 0.1 mil decrease equates to about $88,000 in decreased revenue for the district. So the budget I have it set up is it has a 0.1 decrease in it. The finance committee met a couple weeks ago, and with a 0.1 or a quarter mil, again, with the way things are going, I recommend the 0.1, but again, I could change that between now and the 17th, if the board so chooses. The state revenue, Governor Wolf's budget calls for a $833,000 increase in our basic ed funding. There's no way to make that. I don't know. If we do, I'll be shocked. But I budgeted about a $225,000 increase. That might even be a little aggressive. I did put the special ed a number in there, which that's a $156,000 increase. And this has been bothered me for the last 16 years. State property tax allocation actually went up for the first time ever. Every year, I memorize our number, $644,000 is the amount we've always gotten from the state for property tax reduction. And that number is the number that we use to determine what the homestead exclusion amount is going to be on the tax bill. So it went from 640, I thought I missed something. Nobody said anything about it, it just came out. It went from $644,000 for us to $811,000. That'll change our exclusion. It was about, I'm not sure exactly, but it was 209 last year. I think it takes it up to 267. So instead of getting 200 my knocker bill, you get 267 knocker bill. You would think that after 16 years and how many casinos they put up and how much revenue is coming in, I think they figured out they needed to do something on that. So, yeah, I'm shocked that it happened. The revenue on the transportation side, transportation subsidy is based on prior year costs. So last year's cost, or this year's cost, we'll get, based on how much we pay this year for transportation, we'll get revenue next year based on that. So our transportation costs next year are going to be significantly higher than they were this year. But our reimbursement next year is only going to be based on a lower amount. So it'll catch up the year after. So that'll be a hit for us for next year. As our aid ratio increases, our reimbursement decreases. Our transportation reimbursement is based on our aid ratio. Our aid ratio decreases, that should say decreases. Our reimbursement decreases as our aid ratio decreases. And I can go over that too. Federal revenue, there's still a lot of ESSER 1, 2, and 3 funds remaining to be spent. And that kind of reflects in the increases in some of the positions that we're recommending for that. The title program revenue is expected to be similar last year. And the access revenue, it's just, it's, it continues to be reducing every year, and it's getting harder and harder to bill for this stuff, and some districts are even considered getting rid of the program altogether and save a staff member, because it's a lot of, just a lot of work for a little bit of money. So but we'll continue to do it at this point. Just a graph, revenue by source, local revenue 67% of our total revenue. That was 64 a couple of years ago, so it's the burden's still on us. Okay, just some expenditure highlights. Our health trust rate increase for health care was 1.5. That just came out last week or 2 weeks ago. Charter school costs have stabilized, but they were significantly lower than they were. They were lower pre-COVID than they are now. COVID sent a lot of people back to charter schools, and they haven't necessarily come back yet. Some did, but more than I thought have stayed. Heating oil costs are not locked in for 22-23. It's going to be a big hit to us because we're currently paying $1.25 for this year. So we locked in that rate a year and a half ago. The current futures pricing is over $3 for us, so it's going to be a big hit. Now, I didn't necessarily reduce the budget to reflect the 1.25 down, so there's not going to be a big hit, as big of a hit as there should be next year. But it's going to be a high number for fuel costs for next year. The thing is, our electricity is locked in at 5.55 until 10 of 24, so that's a good thing. I've been worried about that for a while. And that electricity rate is way high right now. Transportation rates have significantly increased this year due to the driver shortage and fuel costs, so we'll take that hit this year. And increased bond payments, we knew that was coming, so we had that built into the budget. And staffing increases are funded mainly by ESSER. Most of them are funded by ESSER.
What are the rates at right now?
For what?
For the new bond.
I haven't had them changed, but he has a 5% bond in there. As a he's very, very conservative on his estimate. So
4%.
Huh?
5% interest.
Yeah. It's not gonna be that. Debt service. Okay, that's where we are here. So our current annual debt service is $2.45 million. That's how much our net payment for bonds is, $2.45 million. Next year, our debt service, if we didn't do anything, our debt service would reduce by $754,000, and in the next year, it would be down to $881,000. So by 2025, we would have over $1.5 million decrease in our debt, in our bond payment in 2025. So the proposed $62 million bond increases our debt service next year by 1.4. So instead of going down, it's going to go up by 1.3 million. And that's basically what we have to cover in this budget and every future budget going for the rest of my life. And the revenue is already available for that increase. The rates are rising, and the professionals have begun the process, and they're waiting to be able to determine the terms. So we'll probably do this bond issue in midsummer, in August. We're probably going to close in August. All the work will be done ahead of time, but we'll probably close in August. The millage rate trend, 2009, we were the seventh highest millage, and now we are currently the lowest millage. Our rate is lower now than it was in 2009. First County Schools, their average millage rate increased by 19.2% since 2009, and ours decreased by 4%. The warehouse growth is continuing, and I'll show you a little some information on that, but it's slowing down. Again, the homestead farm set exclusion, I talked about that. There are 28 2861 Homestead approved, and 203 Farmstead. So, I already talked about this. So it's going from 209 to 264, and that's estimate right now. So it's a $55 reduction for every Homestead Farmstead that's approved. There's also a Department of Revenue property tax and rent rebate program that is still available. And anybody that just go to the Department of Revenue website to see if you qualify, there's an income limits on that, but you could check that out. $650 based on your income qualify. So we're looking at approval of the preliminary budget and Homestead Farmstead, the resolution for Homestead Farmstead. We could approve that even though it's not on your agenda. We can put that on the agenda now that I have the numbers. I typically don't have the numbers yet, but I just got the numbers last week. Approval to do that for May 17th. This is no tax increase for the 10th year in a row, and it's decreased for the last 6 years. Current year budget reflects a 0.1 decrease. State and federal revenue, I don't know that, I'm just projecting those numbers at this point. And there's a lot of other numbers I don't have. Insurance rates, heating, personal related issues, what we're going to approve and not approve. But in any case, the tax bills will be mailed on 7-1. So let me just go to spreadsheet and go over some of the summaries. This is the budget summary based on the different. This is by function, compares last year's budget to this year's budget. Regular instruction, $328,000 increase. You see the biggest increases are going to be in transportation, $800,000, and in debt service is going to go up by $1.2 million. But our budget, we had a budget transfer in the budget last year of $1.5 million. I mean, reducing that to just $1 million. And if we keep that $500,000 to fund other projects, not necessarily the high school project. But those are the biggest increases there. Special education has a big increase. Most of those are due to staffing changes. And so the total it's balanced budget of $38,496. That's going to change between now and 2 weeks. A lot of things that have to be, and even after the preliminary budget is done, things are going to change. So, but that's the summary there. So this, just to show you what the real estate tax is going to do. So, if we did nothing, the increase in tax would be $2.8 million just in real estate taxes. And the increase, if there was a 0.1 mil decrease, it would be $2,050,000. And again, that's a reduction of $88,000. So you, if it was a quarter, we had talked as a finance committee about a quarter mil decrease. Just to see, so that would be a $219,000. Decrease in our revenue. It's hard to see there. Sorry about that. But it's $219,000 decrease for the quarter mil. So that's where we're at. Let me go back to some of the warehouse things that we talked about. Okay, so these are the completed warehouses. So we're looking at a total assessed value of $299 million. in assessed values, which equates to about, to roughly seven, a little over $7 million in revenue over the, since Dollar General and the Perks 78 started. So that's roughly $8.17 million of property tax that if we had, warehouses weren't here, to get the same level of funding and for the district, we would have to have raised our rates by 8.17 mils. But luckily the warehouses came in and are covering that. So currently under construction, there are three warehouses that are currently being constructed over at the Frystown exit. They're all Vesper-owned properties. And there's two right on 78, and that's lot 2 and 3, and lot 4 is up on the top of the hill. That's the bigger one. So I anticipate those to be completed probably sometime in the fall, and at least 3/4 of the anticipated revenue of $948,000. That's what our ongoing after they're completed would be $948,000 going forward for those properties. So that's, those numbers are built into our interims for next year. Now, there is one caveat to where we are. The North Point Perks is, it might be our biggest warehouse. Amazon is our biggest, but that one's our second biggest warehouse. That one, we just got the information from the county to build that one, and we won't be able to send the bill out until May 15th. And they'll have 60 days to make a payment. So if they pay it before June 30th, it'll be considered revenue this year. If they pay it after June 30th, it's next year's revenue. So that bill is a, well, it's a $932,000 bill, of which it goes back to October, so it's 3/4 of that amount is what that bill is going to be. So I'm projecting that we're going to get it. If we don't get it, we're going to get it next year, but it won't be in next year's budget, so it will happen. So. I just don't know if it'll be paid before the end of the year. So these are the proposed projects that are currently in the works. We have Audemars Transport on Bell Road. We have the Bowman development on 645 and I-78. Airscape on Airport Road, which would be kind of behind Horning's warehouse there and Spinnaker there. MB Investments, Ascaro, which is on the same side of 645 as Pilot, but just to the south of Pilot. They're proposing two warehouses there. There, at least there's a sign there for them. So those are possibilities. I don't have any of these as definite yet, but that potentially is another $1.8 million coming down the road at some point. There were warehouse sales over the last few years that we got transfer taxes on them to the tune of $1.3 million. And the ones that I already talked about. So that's where we are with warehouses.
What are you projecting for this current year of revenue over expenses?
Our revenue is fairly close to projections, but expenditures should be about We should have about $1.5 million transferred capital reserve, so $1.5 million. This is something about the warehouses and that was interesting. So back in 1999, the 10 highest taxpayers were totaled $13 million. 10 years later, the top 10 taxpayers were $15 million. 12 years after that, the top 10 taxpayers equal $309 million, an increase of 1,902%. So these are the highest assessed values on some of these warehouses. So all of these, the top six, each one of them have a higher assessed value than Burnville Borough. Whole Burnville Borough. Burnville Borough's assessed value is $32 million. So that's where we've come in the last 10 years. So that's just a graph of that. So $13 million to $15 million, and then we're $309 million. So that's that. Our income tax graph on that. That's been growing significantly. Last year, remember, we budgeted less, thinking that the economy was going to go bad, and it didn't. It just kept on going. And this year, we're projected to be at $1.67 million, which is about $100,000 over what we budgeted. So that's good. Real estate transfer tax. This is where I said I'm not a very good budgeter. I've been up and down on this. If I go low, we get high. If I go high, we go low. But historically, we've been budgeting around $200,000-some, but the last couple of years, 2 years ago, we had $1.1 million in revenue. Which we had two warehouses sell in that year. This year, we're projecting to be at about $674,000, way over the $250,000 budget. And again, I can't project what's going to sell, you know, in a year. So that's where we're at. This debt graph, I talked about the debt. We're going to be currently at $2.45 million. Next year it goes down by $754,000, $1.695, and then it goes down to $881,000. If we did nothing, our bond payment would be $881,000 for the next, until 2030. But when the bond payment will go up by, it's going to be basically $3.8 million for the next. It goes out to 2049. I think that's what I'm trying to check out.
2.8 to 3.8.
It goes to 3.8. So it goes from 2.45 to 3.8 million for ever. I think that's about it. Medical costs, I have, 1.5% was a rate, but they're going to go up 4.8% for us because we have different number of plans and we have changing plans. So that changes daily. That's all I really have.
So you're budgeting 4.8?
No, that's what it comes out. I'm budgeting 1.5. But because there's people changing plans and more people on the plans, our medical costs are going up.
Well,
new employees. Yeah.
But why wouldn't you budget 4.8?
Well, that's just what it comes out to. budgeting what the increase is going to be, but a little.
Okay. So this.
Yeah.
That'll cover it, the 1.5 will cover it.
Yes. So, I don't know. So basically, I have a, it's built with the summary here, and you'll get the PDE form next 2 weeks to go over it. And these things will change, but it's basically $3.85 million budget. You'll be looking to approve that next 2 weeks with detail from the home state form. Any other questions?
What did we go down last year? Like, it was half. You're saying a quarter this year?
What's that? Five of the last year.
Yeah, we went down 3/4 of the last year. We're in, yeah, 26.75 to 26.
That's budgets with content right now.
Yes.
Wish we knew where the bids came in before. So.
Yeah, that's why I know we had talked as a finance committee about 0.25 and 0.1. Easily can change to 0.25, but at this point I think 0.1 is the only one here.
This comes in too high, we have the option to reject them.
You're looking at
220K.
How much?
220K, quarter mil. 0.25.
I know last year we talked about trying to do it from the quarter mil this year.
So 880 a whole mil, so 220 for 0.25. So if you go half a mil, it'll be 440.
So we opened bids on the 21st. So we'll have a good idea that after. Now this is tentative, and it could get pushed back depending on timelines. But tentatively, bids will be open on the 21st. We would be approving the final budget on that night. So we could always adjust based off of where the bids come in. There is going to be a special board meeting. Right now we're tentatively looking to have a special board meeting either on June 23rd or June 30th, depending on where the bids, the timing of them opening, to award those bids. So the budget needs to be passed by June 30th. So we do have some time, we do have that opportunity to adjust if we need it.
To Bill's point there about pushing the project off depending where the bids come in. I did a little figure today, and Bill and I are going to differ on this till we're in the grave. We kicked this can so far down the road that when I came on the board, this was a $30 million project. And now look at where we're at. But the point I want to make is, if we hold off on the bids, and we can save, let's say we can save $10 million, but our interest rate goes up 1.5%. It costs us $13 million more in interest over 20 years. So we lost money again. So if we don't, we gotta look at the full circle. We can't just look at the sticker shock, and we're gonna be sticker shocked. I don't care how we look at this. But we gotta make sure we look at it full circle. Just my opinion.
Yeah. ECIU is they're scrambling to get locked in. I'm not sure they did the same thing with Magnus Plus, but now all of this is just kind of saying, let's lock it in now. But they're afraid it's going to go higher. So.
Any other questions?
So we're going to chew on the millage rate this meeting. Chew on it.
But this is just for next time anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, full, what you'll be approving next 2 weeks is going to be the state form, the official preliminary budget form. So you'll we'll have that ahead of time.
All right. Moving on to finance C, approve the following institutions as repositories for 2022-2023 school year. We got the Pennsylvania School 2022-2023 school year as listed. D, appoint Matthew Little as board treasurer for a term beginning July 1st, 2022 and ending June 30th, 2023 for a stipend of $500.
Questions on that? Moving on to personnel, Mr. Palmer.
Personnel, this is a voting motion. I move that we approve the following volunteers for the remainder of the 21-22 school year as listed there.
I second.
Comments? Roll call.
Heck?
Yes.
Bats?
Yes.
Coffin?
Yes.
Yes.
Shaw?
Yes.
Palmer?
Yes.
Petrick?
Yes.
Lytle?
Yes.
All right. Policy. Mr. Hackman, take care of that one.
Yes. The second reading of final approval of all of the policies. Can you read them all or just as listed?
As listed. Question. All right, up to the fun stuff. Administrative reports. We'll go in order that they're written here tonight. Mrs. Demianni.
Okay. So we are in the middle of PSSA testing, and the students have been working very hard. It is a team effort. Schedules have to be moved around, and makes for a different schooling for everyone. But students have done a great job. And our school counselors have a lot to do with the organization of and logistics of all of that, so a special thank you to our school counselors. I am in full swing of hiring, which Dr. Nepsik knows is one of my favorite things to do, but I take it really seriously because we've been hiring these people for over 30 years, so it's a big deal. I currently have 4 teaching positions open at my building, emotional support, and we share an art position, so those are underway, and we have a lot of qualified, wonderful candidates, so that's really exciting. And I know that next board meeting, you will be meeting the members of the Penn Vermont CAN structure team, aka Lorraining County Champions. And so I will not be able to be here because we are having our kindergarten readiness night, which we just organized, and that's being shared up with families this week. But obviously, it's a really big honor for them to have won, and I'm just going to say that they changed it this year, and Pembroke was up against, they leveled them into levels. They were the expert level, which means they were up against big middle schools, so Wilson West, and I think they're running middle school, so big, large populations, and we still are number one, so go Toby.
Here's your follow-up.
So this week is Teacher Appreciation Week, but as Dr. Netznik said, we're really focusing on all our staff, not just our teachers. Our PTO and two of my paraprofessionals really took this and ran with it this week and have done some really amazing things already for the staff. Today we had a concession stand set up where we had hot dogs on rollers and some, you know, ball game favorites for our teachers. We had an ice cream bar yesterday and breakfast. Tomorrow, we have two local pizza establishments donating pizzas for all of our staff, so I want to thank all of those people. And this Friday is going to be, potentially, my first time in Dunk Tank. So our beach bash is going to be this Friday night. I'm going to be finishing off the night, so 6:30. I will be in there until they tell me that I have to come out. But I'm excited to be part of that. This will be my first time actually being able to host that, so I hope the weather holds out. It's not looking fantastic, but as we know, we'll do our best. So it's a rain or shine.
All right, guys, it is a very busy time of year, but
very exciting time of year. High school has Keystones coming up. A big shout out to Mrs. Troutman and all the work she's done with our Keystones. We have prom May 14th, that is from 5 to 10 p.m. I think this year is going to be a beautiful prom, and I know the kids are very excited. We've sold a lot of tickets thus far, so that's exciting. Our baccalaureate is June 1st at 7 p.m. in the Junior Senior High School Auditorium. Our graduation is June 3rd, so fingers crossed, toes crossed that we have great weather for June 3rd. And last item, but not least, this is a big shout out to our art department and Mrs. Overly. Our yearbook has won a national award for our color, so that's something we're very excited to be about. The kids have worked really hard for it. Mrs. Overly worked really hard, so a big shout out to them. Thank you.
For the junior high school, I have a couple announcements. PSSAs, as aforementioned, are wrapping up for us on Thursday with 8th grade finishing science. I'd like to give a shout out to Mrs. Bachman and the school counseling department for really setting the tone and getting that all organized. The 8th graders next Thursday are visiting Gettysburg National Park, so we will be there for the entire day. And last but not least, student council is currently closing in on their goal of raising $1,000 for Four Diamonds. And we're going to be finishing off the year with a kickball tournament during Tractor Day on that May 27th. And if they hit the $1,000 mark, I will be doing the gritty for the entire middle school. So they're going to be teaching me how to do that dance. So fingers crossed, I get to embarrass myself.
I don't know what the gritty is, but I want to see that.
Well, $1,000.
For the third time, the Tomahawk Envirothon team won first place in counties. They were Kyle Ebersol, Maddie Morris, Cam Garris, Micah Myers, and Cecily Crampton, and they're heading off to states later on in May. Coming up on May 27th, an event unlike any other, Tractor Day. Everybody is invited. Not only are we going to have Tractor Day, but anybody who drives a tractor, any community member who comes out gets a breakfast. It's a great breakfast, if you've ever been there. And the kids who ride their tractors get to stay out there. Any students who come out, they can talk to them about their tractors, what year their tractors are, and what kind of farming they do. New this year, big news, PA Farm Show milkshake truck. Yeah. 9 o'clock, it's going to be there. We're excited about that. And if you think we're excited about that, we're having a Bobby Flay barbecue truck. That's from 11 to 2. So come on out and join us there. And then the Scholastic Achievement Banquet. That's May 18th. Everyone should have received invitations for those. Keynote speakers are Bill Hunter, principal at Penn Burnville many years ago, and some dude named Oscar Van Beck. Congratulations.
Since joining the district very end of March, I've been able to be a part of about a dozen meetings with students and families who are not part of the district, whether they're moving to us from my district or turning to us from charter schools or private schools, whether they're looking to enroll or trying to decide if they're going to enroll their child. I just want to thank our admin team, our building admin team. They've really done a great job of giving tours to the students. I tagged along. I got to say, for the experience, you can give a heck of a tour. So a lot of time in the cafeteria, which is weird, but I don't know. But I have to say, at the end of all those meetings, the families are very impressed with what they see, and it affirms what I saw in the district when I first was interviewing here. I got to go on a tour with Dr. Nesman. And all those families are either enrolled or see that they're going to enroll for next year. So we're doing some great things with Tomahawk, and it's exciting to be a part of that.
I totally understand why Mike would want to go to the cafeteria for the most today, because that's where all the good stuff is. I want to talk a little bit about the meal counts this year. At the end of every month, I kind of just look at them, analyze them, and I'm always shocked this year, each month, it's just going up and up and up. And obviously it's free, but you know, even if it's not good, you're not going to eat it if it's free. So I think it's just a great testament to the staff. Another thing I want to mention is they don't ever complain about, you know, these meal counts going up and up and up. At the high school, we've had, you know, 200 kids coming for breakfast in the morning. We had almost 500 kids eating lunch at the high school last month. Overall, so far this year at Bethel, between breakfast and lunch, the four staff there have served over 36,000 meals. Pennburnville, 38,000, and at the high school, the six staff there have served over 70,000 meals. So, just wanted to kind of point that out and take a moment to appreciate them. School Lunch Hero Day is coming up on Friday, May 6th. It ties in with Teacher Appreciation Week, Staff Appreciation Week. School Lunch Hero Day was started by an author 10 years ago, so it's the 10th anniversary. And it's an author who decided to do a series of books about lunch ladies being superheroes. There's 10 books in the series. I like to order the books and give away the kids as prizes. They're actually like comics, so they work well for kindergarten through sixth grade. I have them out at the elementaries. So this Friday is School Lunch Hero Day. I think that's everything I have. Thanks.
A couple weeks ago at Bethel, I was able to participate in an event called Shark Tank with Mr. Gears and Dr. Nexmec. I was really happy to get that invite from Mrs. Sanders just to say, going down, evaluate these kids' inventions. And it was just really fun to be a part of that with those two admin teams and see the kids and their complete different ideas that they've come up with. We had a buildings and grounds meeting at our grounds facility at the high school. Some of the gentlemen here were able to give me a name for somebody that could help us out with the John Deere tractor. He can't pick it up Monday. He should have it back Wednesday with a nice full list of to-dos on it, especially the main four-wheel drive condition. But other than that, that's it. We're just really planning on the summer, getting the summer details and detail lists, getting our supplies ready.
In technology, I'm not sure if anybody mentioned this, PSSAs are occurring right now. So they're all on the computers, so we can sit and just wait for problems to happen, which is a fun event. I just want to give a shout out to Kyle Zellers again. He helped me get the Pembroke cameras are completely installed at Pembroke, so that project is completely finished. Zach and I did all the inside ones, and then he compared all the outside ones for us and worked with me to get them home. Getting ready for, as Chris had mentioned, baccalaureate and graduation of his high school, and concerts are coming up May 15th, 17th, 16th, May 16th and 17th, are the high school and junior high, and then the 5th and 6th grade is that Wednesday, the 18th, if that's a Wednesday, sorry, I don't have my dance right. So obviously there, but they will be streamed, so if anybody can't make it, they'll be on YouTube as well, so thank you.
Old business to discuss. Where are we at with the high school stadium door? Did that adjuster get out here yet?
You asked for a breakdown from the vendor who's fixing it. How much the one door is? So we need to get that from the end. I haven't been able to do that yet. So he needs more information.
We're still in the process. New business.
Does anybody hear anything how the new bus contract is making out recruiting drivers for next year? Or is it too early to tell?
I know there's a question from some of the drivers who were in the teacher system, the retirement system. They wanted to know if they could, they'd have to stay with PCIU if they wanted to stay in the system. If they're maybe closer to retirement, they could rent instead of just leaving. So, I told them to contact me to see if there's anything we could maybe work them into a maintenance schedule or something that we they get some time with us and get in and stay in the visa system. They could drive for Brandywine, but we could find if they're qualified for any work that we have midday, whether it's custodial work or aid work, we can give them some hours during the day to help them. But I haven't heard from anybody. Yeah, it seems like the only ones that had a problem were the ones that were in the system long time.
They did have one reach out to me that I got Tom and Andy with here this evening to give them direction on how the district could help. Anything else? Anybody have anything to add this evening?
Public comment, people? Yes.
Absolutely, stand up, say.
I was wondering, I sit here and I hear tons of lovely plans and great ideas and a lot of fun things. But I was cruising and I found that, and I'm not sure where they get all their numbers from, but it's a website called Public School Review. I don't know if you ever heard of it, but I'm shocked. I looked at Berks County, and out of the 94 schools that they rated in Berks County, Penn Burnville rated 29th out of 94, with a math score of 60% and reading 70%. The junior senior high school ranked 45th out of 94 with a math score of 56% and reading 60%. And Bethel Elementary, where my grandchildren go, were 58 out of 94 with a math score of 49% and reading 58%. I thought, where are they getting these numbers? Let me check where I'm from. I'm from Montgomery County. I checked my high school where I used to live. Springford, math, 87%, reading 89%, rated 8 out of 146 in Montgomery County. Surely, an hour away, they can't be that much smarter. Are we nervous about this? Is anyone upset about this? Because I'm upset about this. And I wonder if I missed something at a meeting. Maybe I can't make all the meetings. But do you have a plan for this? Do we have a plan for academics?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Anybody? Surely you can't be happy with those numbers, right?
I don't know the website personally.
Okay, well,
I don't know
that's
the
what
website
I'm saying. What kind of numbers do you have? Do your numbers dispel these numbers? Like
a little bit, it does. Now, I'm not sure the study that was just in Reading Eagle, just here.
USA News and World Report.
We ranked fairly well. Now, I don't know what the demographics of that ranking, how they analyze, how they come up. We ranked fairly well.
So that was U.S. News and World Report. You get your data from? Okay.
Yeah, it was in the Reading Eagle. It was on the Reading Eagle. It had all the Berks County schools, where they ranked in Berks County and where they ranked in the state.
So let me take a look at that website and kind of see where they pull that data from.
Public School Review for 2022.
And then
what was the school year based on? 2022.
Because if those numbers are true, I think we need a plan. We need a plan.
What were we as a whole, Oscar? You said seventh.
Pardon?
Seventh as in the county.
We were seventh in
seventh
the county.
County.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In that world report that was put out. Compare ourselves to others in the county, you know, some part of it are looking good. The other part, you know, how they actually calculate the number. In my mind, it can be a farce.
Mm-hmm. But I would think somebody should be compiling those numbers. That was great in the financial. Whew, we got the financial down. That was great. But I think somebody should be keeping track of where we are academically.
So that is something that is tracked at the high school. The high school has several years ago, based on some subgroup data, was given what's known as an ATSI label. It's an additional targeted school improvement plan. The high school and the junior high created a plan to address that. Attendance, our special education and economically disadvantaged groups. It takes a look at attendance, it takes a look at academic performance, it takes a look at the graduation project or graduation rate, it takes a look at behavior. So a lot of those supports have been put in place. Mr. Hamrick's building what's called an MTSS system. It's a multi-tiered support system to be able to provide some kind of safety nets or provide supports for those students
that were identified within that ATSI plan. So that's something that we have been targeting. If you look at, and this is where I want to see where the data comes, I will be honest with you, if they're pulling PSSA data from last year, there was not a great emphasis placed on PSSAs during the pandemic, because we knew that there was, you know, the fidelity of the testing. They tested some people in the spring, they allowed people to be tested in the summer, they allowed people to be tested in the fall. So there wasn't a lot of, and I'll be honest with you, there wasn't a lot of stock put into those tests.
Well, that's why I looked at my own hospital thinking, oh, maybe it's COVID, you know, because everybody would have the same issues. But when I saw their rankings, and believe me, I didn't think Springboard was such a, it's not that stellar, but I don't know how they're getting those numbers. And it just concerns me. And honestly, I mean, I'm not brilliant. I'm not a teacher by trade. I'm not dumb. I was an analyst for a pharmaceutical company. I would gladly donate some time if you could identify kids that might need help with reading. Like, granted, I mean, there might be some parent that would take, maybe you don't want, as somebody professional, somebody was a volunteer, but we've gotta help these kids that are dragging down the numbers, or for whatever reason that have problems.
And I agree with you. And what you'll see is when we present the comprehensive plan, the two areas that we do address in the comprehensive plan is our English language arts and our math. Historically, for science, we do at the state average or above. It's a mixed bag for when it comes to ELA and math. So those are areas that within our comprehensive plan, which basically sets the course for the next 3 years, if you will, of overarching where we want to go, that will have those areas addressed. So I don't disagree with what you're saying. You know, we certainly, it's, those testings are a double-edged sword, because they're a measure of what our performance is, but they also don't tell the full story. You know, you'd be surprised that, you know, some of the students that we put out here in front and talk about where they're going to go in life and how successful they are, if you pull their standardized tests, they may not be advanced or proficient. They could be, you know, so it's one of those things. I think there's a lot of data that we do and pull, and at the elementary especially, there's a lot of focus on teachers owning their data, if you will, and being able to come and talk about, you know, where their students' levels are and what they're doing. We've tried to shift a little bit before, especially at the elementary levels, we would simply provide them, here's your data. We're trying to shift that focus a little bit, of put a little bit more ownership on that teacher level to say, okay, come prepared to talk about your data, and we'll engage in those conversations. At the high school, Mr. Hammert's been involved with particularly the 9th and 10th grade teachers at English Language Arts in focusing on the scores, the alignment to the standards, where we are in the Keystone testing. At the 7th grade level, our lead teacher for mathematics has been working with our 7th grade math teacher to also kind of identify some of those kids. So that has been our radar, and we are trying to work through it. But, you know, obviously, you know, you can't turn a battleship overnight. So, yeah.
And I just never hear a plan for that.
Yeah.
So, of course, when I see these numbers, I'm like,
sure,
yeah.
Totally get it.
You know, and I know I met with Amanda because I really know my first grader now isn't getting the things my fifth grader got in first grade. And it concerns me, because I don't want him falling behind. And I talked with Amanda. She was kind enough to show me, like, all their spelling lists. And when I had my daughter contact the teacher, I'm like, you gotta ask. Like, why aren't they getting the spelling test that I'm supposed to get in? And he would say, like, not all our friends are on board or up to snuff for getting ready for the test. Well, then, somebody needs to start some kind of, like, if you're a board-approved volunteer, if someone's willing to meet with somebody to help them get on board, I think you should put that out there or ask if there's people. Because I would think your main goal is to get your numbers good. I want my grandchildren to say, oh, I graduated from Temple Hockley, not what, who, where? You know what I mean. And I want that for, we live here. I want the betterment for the school. Thank you. Thank you for hearing me.
Anyone else? All right. Calendar events is listed there. exciting time of the year, a lot of stuff happening. We will be having an executive session afterwards for personnel items. So motion to adjourn.
Next second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.